You're muted.
We're going to get started in a second. The recording will be starting now. So if you do not want to be recorded, please remain off camera and do not place any comments in the chat box. In the meantime, if you stay muted also, we'll be able to get your questions and answers at the end of the session. So my name is Dr. Garcia. I'm an Associate Dean in Social Sciences. I'll be one of your hosts today. Joining me from Career Services is Brooke Brigham, and she will be also hosting with us in the chat room. So just a couple of things about the chat box. Please make comments in there. Put your questions in there. I'm going to keep track of the questions. If you do have a question that you would like to ask at the end of the session, please raise your hand by using the raise hand button, and it will actually create a line for us here of folks with questions for Director Correa, and he will be happy to answer them. You can also put them in the chat box. So Brooke and I will be manning that and answering any questions that we can as we go along. We'll also be putting a few links to some resources as Director Correa speaks about them. We'll put up links there for you. You can click on them and save them and bookmark them. So with that, Brooke, do you have any few words of welcome for our guest here today?
Thanks, Hector. We're just so happy that we have Director Carrera here today. And I will be in the chat if anyone has questions related to career and placing some information in there too. But that's about it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So without further ado, we're going to turn it over to Jean-Paul Correa, who is the Director of Policy, Outreach, and Inspections in the Office of the Inspector General for Health and Human Services. Director Correa, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Hector. Again, my name is Jean-Paul Correa. I'm Assistant Special Agent in Charge, as well as the Director of Policy, Outreach, and Inspections over at the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Office of Inspector General, Office of Investigations. I know that's a mouthful, but as we get into it, I'll explain what all of those letters stand for. I began my career with HHS OIG as a special agent. Was I muted that whole time?
No, you just cut out at the end. So okay. You began your career as a special agent and then right. You cut out.
Thank you. So I began my career in 1998 as a special agent in the Providence, Rhode Island field office. And I was then promoted in 2005 to assistant special agent in charge in the Boston regional office. And I, at that point, I supervised anywhere from 10 to 30 special agents throughout the New England area. And in 2013, I took a lateral move to become the Director of Policy Outreach and Inspections. And I report to headquarters. And I've been doing that job for the last almost 11 years. So when I come out and talk to people, I'm really talking about alternative careers in federal law enforcement. Because when you hear the term special agent, most people think, of course, FBI or NCIS, things that you see on TV and in movies. But what I want to relay to you is that there are a lot of opportunities within the federal government to be a special agent that did not involve those traditional law enforcement agencies. And in particular, there are lots of opportunities within OIGs, or Offices of Inspector General. In fact, there's over 4,000 special agents who are at OIGs throughout the federal government. Now, what is an OIG? An OIG, or an Office of Inspector General, is an independent and objective unit. Every single federal department has an OIG, and their duty is to protect against fraud, waste, and abuse in that particular department's programs and operations. In fact, there are 72 OIGs in the federal government, and each one of those employs special agents. So most of those inspectors general are presidentially appointed. And what that means is, this is Christy Grimm. She's the Inspector General for HHS, Health and Human Services, OIG. What that means is she can only be removed by the president, and that's to keep her independence. Because we are within the structure of the Department of Health and Human Services, and because we're an OIG, we may be called upon to investigate high officials in HHS. And so in order to keep our objectivity, the inspector general can only be removed by the president and not by the secretary or the head of HHS. Again, because she may be called upon, or our agency may be called upon, to investigate the secretary or other high-level officials. HHS OIG, Health and Human Services, is the largest inspector general's office in the federal government. We've got about 1,650 personnel. And our job is to protect against fraud, waste, and abuse in HHS programs, the biggest of which are Medicare and Medicaid. Medicare is health insurance for people over a certain age, elderly people. And Medicaid is health insurance for people who earn under certain income levels, and it's jointly administered with the states. A very important mission that we have. There are also over 100 programs that HHS OIG has to protect against fraud, waste, and abuse, including NIH grants and child support enforcement, and a lot of other programs that stem from HHS. Now, I want to show you a video that kind of explains who we are, who HHS OIG is, and what we do.
You should not have to worry about becoming a victim of healthcare fraud, waste, or abuse. That's why we're here, to make sure all of us are protected. We are on the ground, working tirelessly to hold bad actors accountable. Detecting fraudulent activities in vital health and human services programs, and harnessing data to protect your tax dollars and ensure quality of care. We don't work for a bottom line, we work for you. We are accountants, data analysts, law enforcement officers, lawyers, and other professionals committed to fighting for your health and welfare. That's what drives us every day by the Office of Inspector General.
So as you can see, we have a huge mission at HHS OIG, and we take that mission very seriously. But we're not just a regulatory agency. We have an impact on the federal government and on the taxpayers as well. So this next video that I'm going to show you talks about the impact that we have.
What keeps you up at night? For us, it's our fight against federal healthcare fraud, waste, and abuse. Because this fraudulent activity hurts everyone, with increased costs for vital health and human services, and potential harm to beneficiaries. At the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services Office of Inspector General, or HHS OIG, our 1,600 plus employees oversee more than $1 spent for the health and well-being of Americans, including children, the disabled, and seniors. And we're delivering results. In 2019, our investigative work resulted in criminal charges against hundreds of individuals. And we expect the return of nearly $5 billion misspent dollars. Our lawyers have taken civil action against nearly 700 individuals or entities. To help curb the opioid epidemic, we released a toolkit to assist our partners in identifying patients at risk of opioid misuse or overdose. And through our audits, we expect to recover more than $800 million. In fact, for every $1 we spend fighting healthcare fraud, we return $4 to the federal government. That's why our watchdog agency is an excellent investment for you, the taxpayer. Yet our work is never done. For the Office of Inspector General, protecting its programs and beneficiaries may keep us up at night, but you can rest easy. For more information, visit us at oig.hhs.gov.
So as you can see, OIG within HHS is a very good investment. We bring back more money into the Medicare Trust Fund than we actually expend in terms of what we do with our operations. Now, within HHS OIG, there's several components. We have our auditors in the Office of Audit Services. We have evaluators and inspectors. We also have an Office of Management and Policy, and then our counsel, which is our attorneys. And the agency, the component to which I belong, is the Office of Investigations. And of course, we conduct investigations related to Medicare, Medicaid, and other HHS programs. as you can see, the one aspect of our job is to do internal investigations. We're kind of like the internal affairs for HHS. And so we do investigate HHS employees when they've committed wrongdoing. But the biggest aspect of what we do relates to HHS programs, operations, and beneficiaries, and particularly Medicare and Medicaid. And we conduct criminal, civil, and administrative investigations to ferret out that fraud, waste, and abuse, and to make sure that people are brought to justice. As I said earlier, HHS has about 600 employees. HHS OIG within the Office of Investigations has about 600 employees nationwide. 450 of those are law enforcement officers or special agents. OIG special agents are responsible for a huge workload. As I said, we've got over 100 programs for which we have to protect against fraud, waste, and abuse. Some of the other things that we do is we provide secretarial protection. So the Secretary of HHS is a high-level government official, and we provide protection 24 hours a day for the Secretary. We have a permanent protection detail, and we also have an opportunity for regional office staff to participate in details when the Secretary travels to different regions. So, for example, if you worked in the Boston region and the Secretary was in town, you could volunteer to participate in a protection detail while the Secretary is present. And we also provide emergency response services. So, for example, when there's a hurricane or a tornado or some natural disaster where the government is sending its staff to take care of people, we have a staff, a group of about 25 special agents who will go down and participate in that operation, usually with FEMA, alongside our other special agents in the government. Now, once you're hired as a special agent with HHS OIG, you go down for some initial training in Glencoe, Georgia. It's called the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center. And every federal agent, other than FBI and Secret Service, who have their own training academies, every single federal agent in the federal government gets trained at FLETC, at the Federal Law Enforcement Training Center. And it's kind of a paramilitary environment. Everybody wears uniforms. You receive training in firearms, training in defensive tactics, physical training, because you have to be in good shape to be an agent, training in how to protect yourself if anybody comes after you, and also legal training. One aspect of my background is that I'm actually an attorney, and so I had a leg up on some of the other students when it came to the legal training, and I lended my services to help out my fellow students when I was at FLETC in getting them through those legal exams. Conversely, I was not the greatest shot at first, so some of them helped me get through the firearms training. So everyone kind of helps each other out down there, and it's about a 12-week program, very comprehensive training. And once you graduate from there, at HHS OIG, we actually have an add-on training. It's called Special Agent Advanced Training, and that takes place at our state-of-the-art facility in Largo, Maryland. And there you learn additional tactics training. You learn additional firearms training, and we also do emergency medical training because our staff has to be trained in how to deal with an emergency, medical emergency that occurs while on duty. And you also learn specific HHS crimes and things that we investigate within our own purview as an agency that you didn't learn in your initial basic training in FLETC. So that program is about 3 to 4 weeks, and after that, we actually have pretty intense training on a quarterly basis. Because we're not like local and state police officers in that we're not using our use of force skills on a daily basis, we've got to be well trained. And I would dare say that we have the best trained force in federal government. Our agents undergo quarterly training in firearms, as well as defensive tactics, and a myriad of other types of training, including emergency medical training that continues beyond the advanced training for quarterly training as well. So we do conduct intense training for all of our agents so that if anything ever does happen, they're going to be prepared for it. What's a typical day like in the life of a special agent for HHS OIG? The great thing is there is no typical day. On any given day, you could be conducting surveillance, you could be doing a search warrant, you could be testifying in court, you could be sitting behind your desk analyzing data, you could be interviewing people for your cases. There are so many different activities that you could be doing on your case, and every agent is going to conduct their investigations differently. As long as you're all coming to the same place at the end and having successful outcomes from your investigations. The great thing about HHS OIG is that you will not have a supervisor standing over your shoulder. They're always there if you need assistance, but we give you the tools to conduct your investigations and we expect you to produce results at the end of the day. So it's a great option for people who are self-starters who can get out there and, you know, form their investigations on their own. This short video just kind of shows you some special agents in action for HHS OIG. You can see some of our impressive results in that video, but you know, we don't work in a vacuum. We work with other agencies such as FBI and many other federal agencies, as well as state and local agencies who all participate in healthcare fraud investigations. And we work together as a team because when you work with other agencies, it's a force multiplier. You know, we don't have an unlimited number of agents to conduct our investigations. And so we often work on teams. We work collaboratively with assistant US attorneys who prosecute our cases for us. So it's a very close collaboration between several agencies when we work to get the job done together. But, you know, it can be a dangerous job. We are facing criminals, and sometimes it can be a dangerous situation that we're walking into, and that's why we're so well trained. And this video will kind of show you a little bit about the types of fraud that we experience and the types of danger that we may encounter.
Tonight, World News investigates Medicare fraud. We have learned that organized crime and foreign gangs are now taking your Medicare money. And here's Senior Justice Department correspondent Pierre Thomas.
These are Medicare fraud investigators, not the FBI. They used to worry about catching mostly nonviolent offenders. Now they're concerned about something far more deadly.
Our folks are out there engaging a criminal element that is dangerous.
For gangs, members of the mafia, and other thugs, Medicare fraud is becoming big business.
It's so easy to steal from Medicare and Medicaid, it attracts a violent criminal element so they can cash in on their schemes.
Crime rings across the country are ripping off taxpayers of millions in Medicare dollars.
In California, we see Armenians. In Texas, we see Nigerians. Florida, Cubans. In the Northeast, we'll see Ukrainians and Russians.
Here's how it works. They set up fake companies like this one in Florida, and each can bill the government for equipment and services never delivered. This one Armenian gang in Los Angeles plotted to steal $30 million in Medicare money. In this undercover video, gang members confront an accomplice suspected of skimming their profits. They threatened to kill him.
Me and you tonight, it's going to be a war. $200,000, bro, it matters.
Police say some of the groups won't hesitate to bribe or threaten to further their scams. Those threats are backed up by high-powered paired weapons.
You found these kinds of weapons at Medicare equipment companies?
These are 50 caliber sniper rifles. Here we have an example of a machine pistol. It actually shoots rifle rounds.
In San Francisco, authorities seized dozens of weapons at a medical equipment company operated by a gunrunner who was working with a Mexican cartel.
These are hardcore crooks, and we got to do something about this. 18,000 new applications every month come into the Medicare program, and we are now realizing that far too many of them are really criminal element and fraudsters.
How are you going to improve the vetting process?
We're going to do that by making sure that these are legitimate businesses, by making sure that we go on site like you did.
Budetti claims in the first year these new measures were put in place, 16,000 companies could not stand up to scrutiny. But officials admit that's only a start to rooting out all that fraud. Pierre Thomas, ABC News, Washington.
So as you can see, it's a very can be a very dangerous job, but it's very rewarding in the end. And one of the important things about our job is knowing that we're bringing people to justice who are defrauding the American public. Whether we're bringing money back into the Medicare Trust Fund or putting someone in jail who's committed fraud, it's very rewarding at the end of the day. And one thing I want to stress is that we don't investigate Medicare or Medicaid beneficiaries or the people who are receiving the services. We investigate providers such as doctors, hospitals, pharmacies, pharmaceutical companies, different people like that who are billing the Medicare and Medicaid programs.
Tonight, World News investigates Medicare.
So you might want to know about a particular investigation. Like, what does an actual investigation look like? And this video talks about some undercover work that we did with respect to a podiatrist. And I actually had a very similar case early in my career. But this video kind of explains exactly the type of process that we go through in some of our investigations.
Medicare and Medicaid, it all adds up to a bunch of paperwork and billing codes for doctors' offices around the country. Doctors know some of those codes are way more lucrative than others, but when the feds crack the code, some doctors get in trouble big time. Dr. Eichen, can we get your side of this, sir?
He's a podiatrist, and oh boy, is he quick on his feet.
Are there others involved in this fraud that you're aware of, Dr. Eichen? Doctor?
Before bolting in his getaway car, Dr. Lawrence Eichen was in federal court having a really bad day, all thanks to some undercover detective work.
Okay, you are all ready for some polish.
Did he deserve prison time?
He deserved prison time.
Health and Human Services Special Agent Gerald Roy sees it all the time. Doctors defrauding Medicare by billing for bogus services.
You can steal millions of dollars from Medicare in a matter of months.
Shh. Don't tell Dr. Eichen. It took him several years to steal a million of our tax dollars.
We're going to make it better.
And it was easy. For years, he treated elderly and disabled patients. By treat, I mean trim their toenails, something that could have been done at their assisted care facilities. As it turns out, those little trimmies only pay $4.80. So Eichen would fudge the billing codes. A 10060 here, a 10140 there, which means nothing to you and me, but everything when it comes to Medicare reimbursement. Dr. Eichen's barely legible signature could have also been interpreted as Dr. Ripoff at your service. He was billing for more complex, not medical procedures.
And how lucrative was that?
It was fairly lucrative. He billed in excess of $2 million and he received in excess of $1 million. One individual. I think it's pretty lucrative.
Instead of $4.80, he was billing between $140 and $170 a pop for a couple minutes of work. According to the feds, he did it more than 8,000 times between 2007 and 2014. The feds believe the vast majority of those incidents were fraud. Investigators showed Ike in the videos. He pled guilty. Before sentencing, Eichen cut a check for nearly $1 million to pay back the fraud, a victory for the program.
Most of these guys don't pay it back?
Most of the time, the money is gone.
Roy estimates up to 10% of the $700 billion spent on Medicare is fraud, and that's why undercover agents are paying visits to doctors like Eichen here in St. Louis and around the country.
You're going to be out there.
Absolutely. We will be out there in one capacity or the other. We may be just passing you in the hallway. We may be sitting, standing with the beneficiary. We may be the beneficiary.
So you may be the patient in one case.
You never know.
Or you may be the guardian or the person with that individual.
Correct. The daughter, the sister, what have you.
The observer.
Yes.
As for Eichen, a once prominent doctor is headed to prison for a year, which was less than the recommended sentence.
Doctor? Not only did Eichen repay the million he stole, he was able to cut a check for more than 700 grand to pay a civil fine. The motivation for the theft? Unknown. If you suspect fraud in the Medicare program, let us know or let Health and Human Services know. A number to their tip line is on our website, KMOV.com. Chris Negus, News 4.
So obviously the motivation for the theft is not unknown. It's greed. And we often see providers who will upcode with a bill for a higher level of service than what they actually provide, or they bill for services they never even rendered. They'll get someone's Medicare number and just bill Medicare. And Medicare is a pay and chase program. So what the money is paid, and then we determine whether or not it was properly paid or not. So we have actually a data analytics unit that runs claims data to determine who is an outlier, who's being paid at a much higher level for a particular service than everyone else. And that's a lot of times how we make our cases. But there are many other ways as well that we get our referrals.
Medicare.
So now you've seen a little bit about what it is to be an HHS OIG special agent and the types of crimes that we investigate. How do you become a special agent? So here are some of the requirements. You've got to be a US citizen. You've got to have a four-year degree is not required, but it is definitely preferred in order to be competitive for the position. You have to undergo a background investigation that includes a credit check and a drug test. Regardless of whether marijuana or any other drug is legal in any particular state, it's still illegal at the federal level. And so that does factor into whether or not you would be hired. We do undergo initial drug testing as well as periodic drug testing on an intermittent basis. We have initial and annual physical fitness tests. You've got to be in good physical shape. When you go down to FLETC, you have a physical efficiency battery at the beginning of your training and at the end to see how your physical fitness has improved. You've got to undergo a medical exam. Obviously, you've got to be in good physical shape in order to be a special agent. You need a valid driver's license because most of our agents will have government vehicles. That's one of the tools that we give to our agents. And you've got to be under 37 years old. And the reason for that is because we have mandatory retirement at 57. And you have to have been working for 20 years in order to retire. Therefore, we can't hire you to be a special agent after your 37th birthday. So we get a lot of 36-year-olds applying for the job because they know it's their last chance if they do want to become an agent. And the other thing is you've got to be able to manage a firearm and physically defend yourself. You've got to have the mindset to know that you're carrying a firearm that you may have to use in order to defend yourself or someone else. And some people, when that's explained to them, they realize that maybe this isn't the profession for them. Other people know they can do it. Now, some of the advantages to being a special agent versus an ordinary government employee is one thing is law enforcement availability pay, or LEAP. This is where we receive an additional 25% of our base salary in order to be available. What that means is you are always on call. But you've got to work a minimum of 25% extra hours in addition. So in other words, we work about a 50-hour work week if you average it throughout the year. And some of that is your workout time. We 6 hours of our week is considered some of our LEAP time that we can use. So that kind of softens the blow of those extra 10 hours a week. But it's a great job. We've got, as I said, you can retire with 20 years of service by your 50th birthday, and you've got to retire by your 57th birthday. Now, what do you get paid to be a special agent? This is the pay tables for 2024 in the Boston region. That includes New Hampshire, that includes Providence, Rhode Island, et cetera. This is less complicated than it looks. You get hired at a particular grade. Oftentimes we'll hire somebody as a GS-7, Government Service 7 is what that stands for. And the salary for a regular government employee at a GS-7 is $62,000. If you're an agent, you make an extra 25%, as I said earlier. So you're starting out at $78,460 a year. If you're doing your job well and everything's going fine, you can then be promoted after 1 year to a GS-9. For whatever reason, most agencies skip GS-8 and GS-10. Only FBI uses those numbers. So you would jump to a GS-9, to a GS-11, to a 12, and then to a 13. Within 4 years, you'd reach your journey level, which is a GS-13. And if you're a GS-13, within those 4 years, your base salary would be $116,000 plus the extra 25%, which would be $146,000. So you'd be making almost $150,000. A year. And then at that point, every year you go up a step. So you go in this direction. Instead of down, you're going to the right. So you get an extra, about $4,000 a year added onto your salary. So you'll never become rich as an agent, but you'll definitely be comfortable. You can be comfortable financially. If you notice down here, these numbers are all the same. There is a cap on federal pay, and it's different every year. This year it's $191,900. So for example, I'm a GS-14 and I've been around a long time, so I'm a step 10. So my salary with the 179 times 25% should be significantly higher. But because of the salary cap, I'm limited to making 191.9. So as I said, you'll never get rich, but you can definitely be comfortable as an agent. I want to talk briefly about retirement. We have three components to our retirement. One is the federal employee retirement system, and this is an annuity. This is, we get paid X amount of dollars for just being retired. And it's based on, there's a formula based on the number of years that you've been here. But basically, it'll be anywhere from 34 to 44% of your high 3 years. That will be your retirement amount. We also have a TSP, or 401k plan. And the government will match up to 4% of your salary if you set aside 4% of your salary into the savings plan. So, of course, you're going to put in that amount as a minimum because they're trying to encourage you to save for your retirement. It's just like in any company that has a 401k plan, there should be a matching amount. So I encourage you, no matter where you end up working or if you're working now, to put the maximum amount that you can afford in your 401k plan because those numbers compound with interest and it really adds up over the years. Now, we also can collect Social Security. And when we retire, since we are mandatory to retire at 57, we actually can collect the supplement, which is equal to our Social Security amount, or it's a little bit less, but it's supposed to supplement us for what we will receive as Social Security once we hit 62 years old. So it's three components. It's a pretty good retirement system. And at least you know that you know, you'll be good moving forward into your retirement. And because we have to retire at 57, oftentimes special agents will go out and have another career. And the great thing about working for an OIG versus a traditional law enforcement agency like the FBI is you become an expert in one particular type of fraud. So for example, at HHS OIG, you become an expert in healthcare fraud. So when you retire, you're highly sought after by different agencies such as Medicare contractors and hospitals who need compliance officers. You're highly sought after for your knowledge because you're now a subject matter expert in a particular field. So that's an important aspect of working for an OIG. You learn a lot about a very narrow subject matter versus traditional law enforcement, where you shuffle from squad to squad over the course of your career, and you know a little bit about a lot of different subject matters. What are some additional benefits for HHS special agents? As I said, we provide you with a government vehicle. We consider that a tool for your job. We pay for your parking and your gas. Obviously, this is for official purposes, and we don't want to see a car seat in the back. We don't want to see you doing anything that's on your own personal time. This is for government purposes, but it really is a great benefit to, you know, if you're commuting into Boston every day or some big city, New York, and you don't have to pay for your own parking, gas, or tolls, that's a significant benefit. But you need that job because we're out doing surveillance, we're out conducting interviews. We have to be in the field conducting our investigations. We are also a very family-friendly agency. We want you to use your vacation time. We want you to spend time with your family. We encourage that. If you come to me at 2 o'clock on a Friday and say your son is playing or your daughter is playing in a Little League game and you want to go watch that game, we're not going to give you a hard time about that. Obviously, unless you're in the middle of a search warrant or an arrest or something like that, you know, you have to use common sense. As I mentioned earlier, we give you the freedom to conduct your investigations as you see fit, and no two agents are going to conduct their investigations the same. We give you the tools to do the job, and we expect you to produce results at the end of the day. Another great thing about this job is the satisfaction of knowing that you're on the right side, knowing that your job means something. It's not just a paycheck. At the end of the day, you're doing something for the public good and for the taxpayers. You're bringing money back into the Medicare Trust Fund. You're bringing money back into the Medicaid program. You're putting people in prison who have committed fraud. You're excluding people from healthcare programs so that they can no longer bill. All of these things contribute to the public good. And it really gives you a great feeling to know that your job means something. As I mentioned before, also, you get to make great contacts so that when you move on to your next job after you're retired, it gives you that great knowledge base and it gives you people that you can make contact with as well. Now, in our agency, there are excellent opportunities for advancement. If you want to get into management, especially if you're willing to relocate to another part of the country and probably cycle through headquarters in Washington, D.C., you can definitely advance quickly in this job. It's definitely a possibility. Now, we don't just hire special agents. We also have non-law enforcement positions. We hire investigative analysts, general investigators, and computer forensics examiners. And those jobs don't have age limits. They're not as prevalent as the special agent positions. That's the bread and butter of what we do, conduct criminal investigations. But we definitely do have opportunities that arise every now and then for those positions to become available. So there is options for people who do not want to get into law enforcement within our agency. Now, I'll briefly talk about my background, because when I go out and talk at colleges and universities, people ask me how I got to where I am, how I got to be in this position. And the interesting thing about my journey is that I had not planned on this being my career. I was a law student. I was told from when I was a young child that I was going to be the attorney in the family. And so I went with the flow. I was a good student. So I went to Boston College, and then I went to Boston College Law School. I took the bar, I took the LSATs to go to law school. I did great on all my exams. I graduated from law school, took the bar exam, and I passed that. And then I thought, now what? Because I didn't really have any passion for any particular type of law that I wanted to practice. So I actually hung out a shingle, and it said John Paul Carrera, attorney at law. My dad owns an insurance agency, and so I started, I opened up a little office in the back of his office, and I practiced law for about a year. And I found it just wasn't for me. And the thing that really spurred that thought in my head was that I had a client who I worked a child support case for her, ironically, where she was trying to get child support from her ex-husband. And in Massachusetts, child support is based on guidelines. So it's based on a formula of what the custodial parent makes and the non-custodial parent, and it just comes out to how much they're supposed to pay based on that formula. Well, this guy decided he wanted to fight it and go to trial. So here I was, brand new attorney, conducting a trial with cross-examination, etc. We won the trial, but basically what the custodial parent, who I was representing, was awarded was exactly what she would have gotten under the guidelines. But I put in all this work, and so I had a bill for this woman for $1,100. And I just couldn't bring myself to hand it to her because she had three children, one of whom was learning disabled. I knew she had no money. And so I decided, maybe this isn't a profession for me. I'm probably not cutthroat enough to do this. And so I was in my doctor's office talking to the nurse one day, and she said, hey, what do you do? And I told her, and she said, oh, I have my sister works for this federal agency who conducts investigations of pension plans, and they only hire attorneys and CPAs, and they're hiring right now. This was 1995. So I drove into Boston, I filled out an application, and I was hired as a pension investigator. And what I found was that it was a very boring job. I was basically a glorified auditor sitting behind a desk, looking at pension plans to make sure they complied with the law. And what you find when you get into the federal government is that if you're an investigator, you want to be a criminal investigator or a special agent. It's more prestigious, it's better pay, it's better retirement. It's just a much better job to have. And so I started thinking maybe I wanted to do that. Well, 3 years later, I was in the gym with my father, and we were walking out together, and someone came up to me and said, hey, don't I see you on the bus to Boston every day? And I said, yeah. And he asked what I did. And I said, well, I'm looking for a federal agent position. And he said, oh, I work for HHSOIG as an auditor, and they're hiring special agents right now. So again, I drove into Boston, I applied for a job, and I got hired as a special agent. So all of that was just by happenstance, happening to be in the right place at the right time. And so my advice to you is to leave yourself open to opportunities that become available, because you never know where they're going to lead. If you had told me when I was 22 years old that I would end up being a special agent working for this federal agency, I would have laughed. I wouldn't have known what it was in the first place. And I would have never believed that this is where I would end up. So keep your options open. Now, we're very proud of our diversity at our agency. We have people from all different backgrounds and walks of life. We have attorneys, we have CPAs, we have nurses because they have that healthcare knowledge. We have computer forensics experts. All of the people that contribute to our mission all bring something different to the table, and they all create a unified force with different backgrounds that make a better whole. In fact, over 31% of our agents are women, and we're very proud of that fact. As of 2022, and I'm sure this number is even higher now, we had 31.52% as women. And we've actually committed to the 30 by 30 pledge, which is something that all law enforcement officers are doing across the country, law enforcement agencies, where they're committing to hire 30% of their special agents or law enforcement officers as women by the year 2030. Now, we're already over that, but we're pushing for higher. And we're going to make a concerted effort this year to increase that amount and get as many women as possible as we can into special agent positions. Now, how do you apply for a federal agent position? Just like any other federal job, it'll be announced on usajobs.gov. And if you don't have a profile on USAJobs, you should create one now. Upload your resume, be ready to apply. We also advertise our jobs on the HHS website, but it's just going to point you to the usajobs.gov site. And you can go into that site and you can set it up for alerts for particular types of jobs, particular agencies, particular geographic regions. And it's a great tool to have and to be ready to go. Now, I always advise people to get involved in internships. Internships are so important for you to learn about different types of careers, to figure out if it's something that you want to do, but also display your good work for people. It can help you make contacts so that you can get a job down the road. We actually have a student volunteer internship program, which is an unpaid internship, but it's a great opportunity with a minimal commitment to get your feet wet, learn about the position, work hand in hand with special agents as they conduct their investigations. You can see here what the requirements are. It's basically about 10 hours per week and about 8 consecutive weeks. So a lot of people do it during the summer between their semesters. Some people do it during the semester. But this is something you apply for through our website. And I think that they're going to put information about that up on the screen eventually for you here. And it's very centered to each region. So we have offices all over the country, and you can apply within that particular office if it's somewhere that's close to you. And we also have pathways internships. Within USA Jobs, there is a students and recent graduates section where all agencies hire their pathways positions. And there are two different types of pathways positions. One is for students, and that is, you've got to have a 3.0 GPA, and you've got to be able to do 640 hours of work within a year. So once you complete that program, the important thing about these pathways internships is you can non-competitively convert to a permanent position. If we have a open position and we like you and we want to have you come work for us and you want to work for us, we don't have to announce that position for everyone to apply to. So you can actually just convert right into a permanent federal position. And that is a huge thing because it's very hard to get a federal agent position, especially right out of college. But if you do these pathways internships, it can be your way to get in without having to compete against others. So there's one that's for students, current students, and one that's for recent graduates. So that concludes my presentation. And if there are any questions, I'll take them now.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Director Carrera. And I know Brooke has captured at least 5 or 6 questions for you. We have 16 minutes to go. So, Brooke, the floor is yours for the question.
Awesome. Thank you. So these first couple of questions, just because I'm going to work backward a little bit because we just touched on the internship program. But first question is there, I know that you said minimum age of at least 18. Are there any other age requirements for the internship programs?
No, there's you just have to be at least 18 and enrolled in at least part time in an institution, in a college or a university.
Great, thank you. And can you also speak a little bit more about the background check information and if there's anything in particular that would disqualify a potential candidate for a position?
Sure. So we look very comprehensively at your background, and we talk to people who knew you at every place that you resided within the last 7 years when you applied for a position. So it's not us in particular. We go through the NBIS, which is a National Background Investigative Service, and they will go out and run criminal history checks. You know, if you've got any criminal history, that's going to be a disqualifier most likely. We run your credit reports. We see if you've got any credit issues, if you owe back taxes, that type of thing. That could be disqualifying because you have to undergo, to become a special agent, you have to have a top secret security clearance. So that background investigation is very comprehensive and very deep. If you've got any, you know, DUIs or anything like that, that could count against you. Any drug issues as well, which I mentioned. So all of those things are going to be incorporated into this thorough background investigation. And the main thing that they're looking for is any contact with foreign nationals. So if you've got contact with foreign nationals, they're going to look deeper into that to see if you have any indication of disloyalty to the United States based on those foreign contacts.
Great. Thank you. And I mean, it was just amazing hearing your story about the what you yourself have, your paths you've taken, and music to my ears from a career lens, just the networking opportunities that you kind of stumbled upon, but were a part of, and all of your hard work brought you. And so thank you for that and for answering those questions. I have a couple other here. There were a few questions in the chat about interest in knowing more about non-sworn positions or those support positions. Do you have a website that they can go to, or can you speak a little bit more to those positions that you put up on the screen?
Yeah, so investigative analysts, they are the people who will run information through intelligence databases to find background information on people, criminal history checks. A lot of times they will also go into the claims databases, Medicare and Medicaid claims databases, to try to work up investigations for our agents, look for anomalies in billing that might lead to investigations. Sometimes those are people who do that job for many years, and sometimes they're people who want to be agents, but they don't quite have the experience necessary to become an agent, and so they'll become an analyst for a few years and then transition into that agent role as well. But the analysts, it's a regular 40-hour work week. We have flexibility on the days that you can work. We have a 5-4-9 plan where they can have one day off every 2 weeks, and they're working 9-hour days. So it's a little bit more flexible in terms of schedule than a special agent position. We also have general investigators. And what a general investigator is somebody who does our civil investigations. So we have these big investigations called QTAMs. And a QTAM is when a relator or an insider in a company files a suit in federal court. And then we can decide whether or not we want to join that suit with that person who filed it. And so that relator, that person, the insider who provided the information that led to our investigation, can actually collect a portion of whatever is recovered. Oftentimes it's from a big pharmaceutical company, and it could be in the millions of dollars. They can get up to 25% of what we recover. But the general investigators are generally the ones who we hand those cases because they're non-criminal. They're civil in nature. It's recovering money. And so oftentimes we'll have people who maybe they were over the age of 37, or they just don't want to get involved in the law enforcement aspect of the job, but they do want to do investigations. So they'll conduct those civil investigations for us, or administrative investigations, as opposed to the criminal investigations. And oftentimes they'll work hand in hand with our agents if there's both a criminal and civil aspect to a case. So we might have a case that has both criminal charges and civil charges, where they'll work with an agent, or with a special agent who's assigned the criminal aspect of the case, and the general investigator will be assigned the civil aspect. And then our computer forensics examiners, they'll oftentimes go out on our search warrants with us. And once the premises is secured by the agents, we have our computer forensics analysts go in and image computers, just download sometimes from the cloud all that information that we had frozen when we started conducting the search warrant, and then they will run, they'll put that information into other computers so that we can then search for evidence on those computers. So they're very important aspects of this job as well.
Great. Thank you for those extra added details. I think that's very helpful. It looks like in the chat that you have a lot of students here who are already browsing the websites, already excited about applying. A question that came in is, can you talk a little bit more about that application process in terms of timing? do they apply? Once they apply, when do they hear more? How does that review and interview process look like?
So let me talk a little bit about the whole process.
Great.
We don't, there are some agencies that will put out an announcement that's like for a year, like FBI will have an announcement open for a year and you can apply at any time and then they can come in and see who's on the list. We put out announcements when we have positions that we need to hire for. And sometimes we'll go through a couple of years without hiring anybody because of the budget, right? The federal budget is, as you see in the news every day, there's continuing resolutions and we don't know for sure what our budget is going to be oftentimes. And so without that assurance, sometimes it's hard for us to hire new employees. But we do backfill for employees when we lose people. And we're getting to the point now where all the people who came in with me back in the 90s are getting ready to retire. And so we've got this looming retirement cliff, this knowledge cliff, where we've got a bunch of people who are going to be retiring, and we're going to need to backfill that those positions. And so, based on budgetary constraints, hopefully we'll be able to backfill many of those positions in the next year or two. I think we're going to do some significant hiring. But what happens is you'll see an announcement come out on USA Jobs, and this is very important. This announcement will come out, and especially for our special agent positions, it'll say this job is open for 2 weeks or until we reach 50 applicants, whichever, the day that we reach 50 applicants, this announcement is going to close at 11:59 p.m. So inevitably, that's going to be on day one. So you've got to be ready. You've got to be prepared to apply the day the announcement comes out, because if you don't, then you could miss out and not be allowed to apply for the position. So unfortunately, that's the way we do things. I think they want to limit the number of applicants they get and have to go through. And so you've got to be ready to apply. Once you've applied, generally it'll take a few weeks to maybe a month or two before someone will get back to you and let you know if you've made the best qualified list. If you've made the best qualified list, then that means now your name has been referred to the hiring official as someone who could potentially be interviewed. And so you may hear from that hiring official in that region who may call you up and bring you in for an interview or do a virtual interview. Nowadays, things are a little different than they used to be. Once you're interviewed, you will know within a few weeks whether or not you've been hired. And let's say you applied for a special agent position and you have not been trained yet. You haven't been to FLETI. You're a brand new agent coming in. We're going to hire you. We're going to offer you a position and you're going to accept it. And it's going to be contingent on, you're on probation for a year, and it's contingent on you passing that background investigation. So we're not like the FBI in that we don't conduct your background investigation before we hire you. We hire you, we may send you to FLETI for your training while your background investigation is ongoing. So if you're not sure about your background and you think you may have something that would be disqualifying, you better be very careful in giving up another position to come work for us, because we've had people who have lost the position after going through training, that we spent $30,000 to send you to training, and then we find out something in your background, and then we rescind your conditional offer, and you're gone during that year of probation. So that's something you need to be very cognizant of. One piece of advice I want to give with respect to applying for jobs on USA Jobs is to make sure that you look at the qualifications in the announcement. What are they looking for? And if you have those qualifications, you want to make sure that you highlight them in your resume. I mean, underline them, bold them, make those words that they use in the qualifications stand out on your resume. Because when the people who look at those resumes in the HR department take a look at them, they're going to be looking for those key words. So whatever those qualifications are, if you possess them, make sure that it's strongly prominent in your resume.
Love that. I'll put the career services information in the chat too for everyone. I'm going to send it over to Hector now.
All right, Director Carrera, this is called the speed round. We have 5 minutes left and we want to try to answer as many questions as we can. So it's a quick answer. What kind of a four-year degree is preferred for the special agent position?
So as I mentioned, we have such a diverse group of people that work for us that every type of degree brings something to the table. As I said, we have attorneys, we have CPAs, we have nurses. So to be a criminal justice major, we might get most of our applications from criminal justice majors, but that's not necessarily the best for the, you know, the position. What's more important is your experience and your background. You know, have you worked in a medical environment so you understand Medicare or Medicaid and the types of fraud that we investigate, internships, those types of things?
Okay, so to be a special agent, you have to be a citizen. What about, can you be a permanent resident with the other positions?
No, to be a special agent, to be any federal employee, you have to be a U.S. citizen.
I knew that, but I want you to answer it. Somebody said, can you buy back federal time from another agency for this position? Or can that factor in the GS level upon hiring?
You can definitely, it can definitely factor into the step. You might be hired at a particular, it might factor into the GS level if it's a 7/9 position and we're hiring for a GS7 and GS9, and you've got previous experience of more than a year as a 7, you might be hired at the 9 position. If you're hired in as an 11 and you were previously a GS12, you might get hired at a higher step on the scale. So you might get more money, but you're still a GS11 because that's a position you applied for. As far as buying back time, I know that you can buy back your military time, and I'm not sure how that all works, but I know that there is the ability to do that.
All right. So somebody said deferred adjudication for criminal act, does that disqualify potential candidates? And I guess that's all dependent upon the charge. Was it jaywalking, exactly, or was it, you know, possession of cocaine with the intent to distribute?
Right. So, if it was domestic violence, you're definitely out because you're not allowed under the Lautenberg Amendment to be able to even carry a firearm. So if you can't carry a firearm, you can't be a special agent.
And that's for police also. So if you're involved in domestic violence, you're out. We don't want you. Somebody said, do I stand a chance at any position because I'm 57 years old?
Absolutely. Not special agent.
No, because you got to be under 37.
Right. But, you know, if you saw an announcement for an analyst position, we would absolutely consider that based on your education and your experience. You could be a great candidate.
What about the promotional potential for investigative analysts and general investigators? Do they have a good chance of moving up?
That's a great question.
Do they require secret clearance? And I know the answer is, but go ahead.
Yeah, so they don't. They require secret clearance, not top secret, at those levels. And really, the vast majority of our management positions are for special agents. But we do have some in our administrative operations branch who are not special agents. But I'd say that the opportunities are few and far between within the Office of Investigations. Now, if you went to work for our Office of Audit Services or evaluators and inspectors, there would definitely be that potential there. And you can, you know, transfer within the OIG if that's something that you're interested in as well, from one component to another.
Right. I'll answer Kathleen's because it's about graduation dates. She says that her capstone is in February. She's not conferred until May. You're still a student. You're not officially considered to be graduated until your conferral date. So you have until May 4th.
Okay.
And then the last question from Donna says, is the website the same for jobs as an analyst? So is that a one-stop shop, usajobs.gov?
Yes, it is. For all federal positions.
All of them. It doesn't matter what department.
It's just there's a different series. So every federal position has a 4-number series. So for special agents, it's 1811. You might hear that phrase sometimes, but it's 1811. For investigative analysts, it's 1805. So they're in the 1800 series, which is investigative positions, but just different numbers to designate the position.
Okay, so Brooke has placed in the chat box, the last thing there, you know that at STU, you have career services throughout your time here and for the rest of your life. So this is a lifetime benefit. So she can prepare you for resumes, cover letters, interview prep, and help with filling out that application on usajobs.gov. So you have her phone number there and the email. And remember, this is available to any student during your time or after. So with that, I want to say thank you to Brooke for hosting this for us today. And of course, the director, Carrera. So any parting words, what words of wisdom can you give our students who are seeking to get a job, either sworn or non-sworn at HHS? What would be three tips that you would give them?
Well, most importantly is consider doing an internship, whether paid or unpaid. Get that experience, get your name out there, make those contacts, learn what you like and what you don't like, because life is too short to go into a profession that you're unhappy in. And find what's going to make you tick. Find out what makes you tick and find the career that fulfills that. Because you don't want to be lying on your deathbed wishing that you'd done things differently. So try to make those good decisions early in life. And the other thing is put money into your 401k plan. Put that away early and often so that when you retire, you'll have that nest egg. That's it.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you to all the students. Directly. I appreciate you joining me today.
I dropped his email into the chat box. He told me he would be more than happy to answer all of your questions that you may think of later as you go through the day or the weekend. So with that, you have his contact, and we are glad that you came out. And of course, you have us too, so feel free to reach out. Best wishes, and if you need anything, of course, please feel free to reach out to us. And with that, I bid you a good day, and we'll catch you next time on Unlocking Career Opportunities. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks all. Have a good day.